What's up, friends and goats? You are listening to the Command Valley Podcast. I am your host, Griffin, and today we have a deck tech for Athreos, Shroud-Veiled, the legendary enchantment creature spoiled for Theros Beyond Death coming out in January. He is a 4 white and a black for a legendary enchantment creature god, a 4/7 indestructible. As long as your devotion to white and black is less than 7, Athreos isn't a creature. At the beginning of your end step, put a coin counter on another target creature. Whenever a creature with a coin counter on it dies or is put into exile, return that card to the battlefield under your control. So let's go ahead and go through the sixfold path of building a commander deck. The first step is choosing a commander. Now for our commander today, we have Athreos Shroud-Veiled. Number two, we have to decide our strategy. Now for me, when I first saw Athreos Shroud-Veiled, I was thinking of more of an aristocrats style deck. However, what I found out with Athreos is that his real ability lies in his Reanimator strategy. Something that I wanted to point out about Athreos, that what makes him very unique, is that instead of when it dies, returning it to the battlefield, it also counts when a card is exiled. Now you do have to wait until the end step to point a coin counter on any creature that includes your opponent creatures, but for this deck, we're going to really have fun with the Reanimator shenanigans that Orzhov is very proficient at doing. Now for the third step of our sixfold path, how are we going to reanimate and what are we going to reanimate? So I wanted to go ahead and real quick before we get onto the creatures that we're going to reanimate is just talk about some of the reanimate spells. Now, two of the creatures in this deck that count as reanimation spells are Whisper, Blood Liturgist, and Phyrexian Delver, which are two creatures that can reanimate creatures from our graveyard. A couple of spells that can reanimate for us, Blood for Bones, Living Death, Reanimate, Victimize, Animate Dead, Debtor's Knell, and these last two I wanted to talk about a little bit more. The cards are Corpse Dance and Dawn of the Dead. When we look at these two cards, we'll look at the clause on these cards that say that we have to exile them at the end of the turn. However, the reason why this deck is very unique is that Athreos, once we have put in a coin counter on these creatures, even if they are exiled, they will come back. So the play sequencing that we're hoping with Athreos is to play Corpse Dance, put target creature on top of our graveyard onto the battlefield, and then at our end step, we choose the trigger for Athreos first and Corpse Dance second to be able to put a coin counter on it, which then exiles from Corpse Dance and brings it back onto the battlefield under our control. I wanted to start off with creatures that cost less in our reanimation section. Now, a couple of these cards, I want to include all of them, but some that I wanted to point out are cards like Ravenous Chupacabra, Mother of Runes, False Prophet, and Bounty Agent. These are creatures that, while they cost less, have a lot of utility, and you will not be upset bringing these back to the battlefield before we have our big creatures out. Now, going on to the high casting costs and the huge creatures that we're going to be slamming down, I wanted to separate these into two categories. The first category is the more budgeted side. A lot of these creatures are less than $2 and will work just as well as some of the more expensive cards that you can get. Now, the second one is going to be our higher budgeted for those of you who are not worrying about the budget. For our budget cards, we have Angel of Despair, which is a 7 mana angel that when it enters the battlefield, it destroys target permanent. Avatar of Woe, which is a 8 mana avatar that can tap to destroy target creature and it can't be regenerated. Another one we have is Sepulchre Primordial, which is a 7 mana avatar with Intimidate. When Sepulchre Primordial enters the battlefield, for each opponent, you may put up to 1 target creature card from that player's graveyard onto the battlefield under your control. Now, this card is a real all-star in this deck. However, we need to remember that we need to focus on our creatures first before we focus on other creatures. Now on to our larger budget. For those of you who want to pack in the punch with these creatures, I have included Shouldered Whispering Wand, which is a 7 mana praetor. At the beginning of your upkeep, you may return target creature card from your graveyard to the battlefield, and at the beginning of each opponent's upkeep, that player sacrifices a creature. Super great thing to reanimate. We can just keep reanimating things constantly, and with the Athreos loop, it can get a little bit nuts. I've also included the 3 Eldrazis, the ones which do not shuffle themselves back into your library. The reason why is because we want to have targets for our reanimation spells, and if they're shuffled back into our library, we won't have them to reanimate. So these ones are Ulamog, the Ceaseless Hunger, Kozilek, the Great Distortion, and Emrakul, the Promised End. Keep in mind with these creatures, these are just some of the many, many creatures that you can include into this deck. I just want to point out that this is going to be your deck all in all. So please include the creatures that you want to play. If you want to play Infect, you can grab Scythrix. If you want to be a little bit more control, you can play Platinum Imperium or Platinum Angel. This deck is really up to you about what you want to reanimate. The last part of our strategy and how to win, I've included two separate combos I've included in this deck for those of you who want to use a combo to close out the game if it's running away or to make a game go by quickly. The first one is the Revelark, Karmic Guide, and Blood Artist combo. The first thing that we're going to need for this combo is Karmic Guide. Karmic Guide is a 5-mana Angel Spirit with flying protection from black. When it enters the battlefield, return target creature card from your graveyard to the battlefield. The second one that we need will be Revelark, which is a 5-mana, 4/3 elemental with flying. When Revelark leaves the battlefield, return up to 2 creature cards with power 2 or less from your graveyard to the battlefield. And the last one is our classic Blood Artist, which reads, whenever Blood Artist or another creature dies, target player loses 1 life and you gain 1 life. Now the last thing we're going to need for this combo is a Sacrifice Islet, such as Ashnod's Altar. Now to use this combo, what we need is to have Revelark and Blood Artist either in the graveyard or Blood Artist in the battlefield. Doesn't really matter where Blood Artist is. However, the loop happens when you cast Karmic Guide, returning Revelark back to the battlefield, sacking to Ashnod's Altar before Revelark enters the battlefield. Then as Revelark enters the battlefield, you return Karmic Guide back to the battlefield. Before that happens, you use Ashnod's Altar to sack the Karmic Guide. Now this is a loop that you can go infinitely, and if you have something like a Blood Artist or a Zulaport Cutthroat, you can drain everybody else from their life on the same turn. The next combo I have in here is the Nim Deathmantle and Grave Titan combo. Now for this, we're going to need the Nim Deathmantle, which is a 2-mana equipment. Equipped creature gets +2/+2, has Intimidate, and is a black zombie, and equips for 4. However, whenever a non-token creature is put into your graveyard from the battlefield, you may pay 4. If you do, return that card to the battlefield and attach Nim Deathmantle to it. The next one we'll need is Grave Titan, which is a 6-mana giant with Death Touch. Whenever Grave Titan enters the battlefield or attacks, put 2/2 black zombie creature tokens onto the battlefield. Now the way that this works is that we have Grave Titan in our hand and we cast it with Nim Deathmantle on the battlefield. Now Grave Titan is going to make 2/2 zombies along with Grave Titan that are going to enter the battlefield as well. Now for this we will also need an Ashnod's Altar to get this loop going. The way this works is that we're going to use the Ashnod's Altar and sack both the zombies to add 4 into our mana pool. Then we're going to sack Grave Titan to the Ashnod's Altar. Now we have 6 colorless mana in our mana pool. Using 4 of that, we will use the ability on Nib Deathmantle to pay 4 and return Grave Titan from the graveyard to the battlefield. And as it does that, it enters with 2/2 zombies as well. Now we have 2 mana floating in our mana pool. With this, now we only need to sack 1 zombie and the Grave Titan to continue this loop, creating either infinite mana or infinite zombies. And of course, with a Blood Artist or Zulaport Cutthroat, we can drain all of our opponent's life in the same turn. The next step on our sixfold path to how to build a commander deck is our protection. Now in this deck, since we have Athreos on the battlefield, the coin counters are a pseudo way of protecting our creatures because they will return to the battlefield when they die. However, a couple of other cards I wanted to include as protection are Blind Obedience, which is a 2-mana enchantment that reads, artifacts and creatures your opponents control enter the battlefield tapped. Another one that I've included here is Phyrexian Reclamation, which is 1 mana for an enchantment where you can pay 1 and a black, pay 2 life, return target creature card from your graveyard to your hand. Now this can help if a creature is removed before we can put a coin counter on it. The third I have included in here to protect ourselves is a land, which is actually Hall of Heliod's Generosity. Now this is a legendary land from Modern Horizons where you can tap to add 1 mana, or 1 and a white, you can tap it to put target enchantment card from your graveyard on top of your library. The reason why I've included this card is because even though our commander Athreos is indestructible, it can be removed. And having to cast Athreos from the command zone for 8, then 10, then 12 can be a little bit taxing for our strategy. The Hall of Heliod's Generosity allows us to return it back to our hand since it is also an enchantment when it's in the graveyard. The last one I wanted to include is Ghostly Prison, which is a 2 and a white for an enchantment. Creatures can't attack you unless their controller pays 2 for each creature they control that's attacking you. The reason why I've included Ghostly Prison is because this deck and the way that I've made it is a little bit slower to start. Ghostly Prison will be an excellent way of de-incentivizing our opponents from attacking us first, so that we can start rolling out our game plan as the game goes on. The final step in the sixfold path to building a commander deck is the interaction. Now the interaction in our deck is also important because we can remove our own creatures with coin counters and other opponents' creatures with coin counters on them. so we can pseudo instant speed return them to the battlefield under our control. A couple of removal spells, I'm not going to include all of them, but a couple of good removal spells are Anguished Unmaking, Mortify, Swords to Plowshares, Utter End, and Vindicate. I also wanted to include our three board wipe-esque effects. The first one being a classic Wrath of God. Then we have Cleansing Nova, which is a 5-mana sorcery. You can either destroy all creatures or destroy all artifacts and enchantments. And the last one is going to be the False Prophet board wipe. Now let me explain this one real quick. False Prophet is 2 white-white for a 2/2 human cleric. When False Prophet is put into a graveyard from the battlefield, exile all creatures. The reason why this is a board wipe-esque effect is because in our deck, this will be repeatable. False Prophet will come into the battlefield. Athreos will put a coin counter on it. Now we can sack the False Prophet at any time with our Ashnod's Altar or our Viserys Seer to exile all other creatures. Using this, we can bring False Prophet back from the graveyard to the battlefield. That's about it for our interaction. The last thing I want to talk about before we go on to our reflection period is just the tutors that I've included in this deck. You do not have to include tutors in your deck if you don't feel good about doing those. However, if you do like tutors, here are the ones that I have included. I have included Sidisi, Undead Vizier, which is 3 black-black for a legendary creature, Zombie Naga. With Deck Touch, Exploit, when it enters the battlefield, you may search your library for a card, put it into your hand, then shuffle your library. Now with Sidisi, it's nice because it's a repeatable effect where you can port a coin counter on it, sacrifice it, and bring it back to do the same thing over again. The next that I've included is a budget tutor card, which is Diabolic Tutor. 2 black-black for a sorcery, search your library for a card, and put that card into your hand, then shuffle your library. The last one I've included, a personal favorite of mine, is Liliana Vess. Liliana Vess is 3 black-black for a 5 loyalty planeswalker with +1, target player discards card, -2, search your library for a card, then shuffle your library and put that card on top of it, and -8, put all creature cards from all graveyards under the battlefield under your control. Now on to the 6th step, which is our reflection period. Because I have not built this deck since Athreos has not been released yet, I advise you to build this deck the way that you want it, and when you are finished playing, to reflect and think about this deck in terms of what you want it to be. Do you want more creatures? Do you want bigger creatures, better creatures? Do you want to focus more on getting your opponent's creatures, if that is the meta that you're playing in? Or do you need more reanimator spells and removal spells? Since I have not built this deck, I have not had any reflection to make on this deck. However, please build this deck, and please let me know your suggestions and what you think could make this deck even better. All right, my friends and fellow goats, that is it for our Athreos Shroud-Veiled deck tech. I hope you guys enjoyed. Please check out our other deck techs on our channel. We also have our podcast version, which is Late Night Drive, where we talk about all things Magic the Gathering. Please stay tuned for more deck techs that come out every Monday. We're going to be covering more commanders that are being spoiled from Theros as they release, so please stay tuned. And finally, if you want to see the full deck list, please look at the link in the show notes below. And please comment on this video if you have any suggestions or tips, or even advice for this deck. Please make sure to like and subscribe and share our content for other people to watch and enjoy. Have a happy new year, may you draw well, and may you curve out. That's all from me tonight. Goodbye.